what we are invited, Professor Damon Salim from BRL Ahmedabad. Professor.
Thank you. And we have two speakers in this session. And these are from the fellows of the ANN. Our first speaker is Dr. Shailesh Nayak. And it is my privilege to introduce this first speaker, because I know him personally so well for the last 2 decades or more than that. So it is my honor to introduce this first speaker. Dr. Shailesh Nayak is a distinguished scientist at the University of Earth Sciences, Government of India. He obtained his PhD degree in geology from University of Baroda in 1980, and he was the secretary of the Ministry of Earth Sciences for a long number of years, from 2008 to 2015. He set up the state-of-the-art tsunami warning system for the Indian Ocean and provided tsunami advisories in the Indian Ocean rim countries. He has pioneered the application of remote sensing to coastal and marine environment, and has developed the products for coastal management and services for fisheries and ocean state forecast. So these are very important societal implications. He was instrumental in initiating the studies related to reservoir-induced cyclicity, and he is a fellow of the Indian Academy of Sciences in 2014 and the National Academy of Sciences India in charge in 2015, and the International Society of Photogrammetry and Remote Sensing, and academic of the International Academy of Astronomy. He is conferred the ISC Vikram Sarabhai Award in 2012. So with this brief introduction, I would like to invite my esteemed colleague, Professor Shailesh Nayak, to give his talk.
Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you, Dr. Salim, for the kind introduction. I am also very grateful to Professor Ram Ramaswamy for inviting me and giving me opportunity to interact with you. Today what I am going to talk is about a project which has been undertaken for quite some time, started in actually 2010, initial idea, and the preliminary work we started in 2012, and very recently we completed the pilot stage. So I thought it may be a good idea to brief you about the objective and what we got, above all, the very important project. The triggered earthquakes, of course, this region is pretty well known about the earthquakes, and I thought it may be a good idea to talk about the earthquakes. Now, the triggered earthquakes in last couple of decades has assumed a great importance, especially after the U.S. took up the hydrocarbon from the gas extraction. And of course, there are many such cases. Now it is the latest catalog is about 728 triggered earthquakes have been occurred. And these earthquakes essentially happen because of the embalming of the artificial reservoir, also the underground as well as open cast large mining, the fluid injection, especially the hydrofracking, also the some few cases when seen underground explosion, as well as petroleum exploration. Now, this earthquake, I mean, the until the conclusion was that the our activity, especially the engineering activities, is introducing such earthquakes. But now we know that it is not so. If it is so, then we would have many other places such earthquakes. But essentially what this our activities does is, it releases the pre-existing stress which is already there in that particular region. And so that's why the name is given a trigger. It's something like the revolver where everything is there, unless you press the trigger, the bullet is not fired. So here also our activities are acting as a trigger. trigger, and that's how this earthquakes have been named. Now it has a lot of social and economic implications, because all these engineering activities would be one way or another way linked to some economic activity, and that's why it affects all the society as well. And you must have seen that even in India, whenever some reservoir occurs, there is always an issue that whether it would induce the earthquake or not. There were a lot of discussion when the Narmada dam burst in and the Delhi. And so it is very important for us to understand that what is likely to happen. Now, especially for reservoir, the understanding is pretty good, especially when you inject a fluid, how it triggers the earthquake. But in the reservoir, which is a very large area, and there are many other processes, both the mass stress as well as the pore pressure and many other small factors of the strength of the rock and so on, it is very difficult to model. And we thought that this could be a good problem today, so that whether we can model this reservoir-induced earthquakes. Now, the Koyla is one of the largest trigger earthquake. Actually, is the largest trigger earthquake, which is accepted by all, more or less, is almost 50 years back. And we thought that this could be a very good region to take up such kind of a study. Now, why we took up Koyla? The one important thing about Koyla, there is a large amount of work already been done in Koyla for the last 50 years, and everything is available, the large amount of data, and so many things are available. The second which is most important is that the seismicity in this region has not ceased. Normally, in many such cases, the seismicity ceases after some time. But last 50 years, it is still on. And the very recently, I think on 3rd June, or 4th June, we had an earthquake of a 4th magnitude, where the drilling was on. Also, the other important thing is, it is linked very clearly with the annual loading and unloading. This is the time, this is November, December time, when you have the large amount of earthquakes, and then it becomes lower. This is the period when there is minimum water level. And if you can see this, it will give you much clearer idea that the most earthquakes of magnitude 4 and above occur during November, December. And then when the loading starts, July, August, and also when unloading, when it is at lowest, also we have seen the earthquake occurs. Now, this region is also completely small. It is about 20 km by 30 km, and the earthquake, most earthquake occurs in first 10 kilometers, and within that also most of the earthquake occurs between 3 and 7 kilometers. So this is a very small area which we can monitor, and this small area actually is affected by the reservoir. So we thought that this is a very important site, and of course the lot of discussion went into selecting site nationally as well as internationally. We had an international continental drilling project which is led by Germany, and we had a lot of discussion with them, and after that this site was selected. Now, what we want to do with this, the most important is, we would like to understand and model the genesis of reservoir-induced seismicity. That is the main goal. Now, to do that, the most important part was that we need a direct characterization of the various parameters which we need for modeling RTS. We have been working on this, and from the surface, all geophysical methods, large amount of data is collected. But there is no direct measurements of anything. Where the earthquakes are affected. If I give you a very simple example, like cyclone. Before satellites came, we were not able to really predict the genesis about 10 days before. Because we were not able to observe. Our observation limited about 400 kilometers based on that. When satellite came, we started observing very large areas. Sea surface temperature and many other parameters, and we could model it much better. The same way, we thought that this may be a good idea to go to measure. Now, the why it is possible is, as I told you, that earthquakes are occurring at 12 shallow regions, about 7 kilometers, and we can drill up to that depth. So, in India, we have not done such drilling, except going to see less drilling in the sedimentary basin. But in this kind of terrain, it was not done. Then what we want to observe was the related parameters related to fault, the physical properties of rocks before, during and after the earthquakes, hydrology, there are fluid or gas, temperature, incident stress and pore pressure. So these are the general standard thing which we call the fault zone observatory, which is planned. Now the experimental design, we decided the three steps. The first is the preliminary studies, essentially to decide the location of the pilot borehole. And what we did is we had a 9 boreholes about 1 to 1.5 kilometer deep. That means all borehole we went right to the basement, and even 6 the seismometers were placed. And then also many other geophysical studies which I'll show you slightly later. You can see that this is the region where the seismicity is occurring, and we have placed our 9 boreholes just at the boundary of each of this. So we capture all the activities which is happening with this. Now based on this studies, we were supposed to decide the pilot borehole, which is somewhere here. And the pilot borehole will be about 3 kilometers deep. It will be vertical borehole, and this has been now completed on June 11 or something. And then based on this we will have a deep borehole. Now we have not finalized the actual design yet, whether it would go vertically. The inclined idea is that this should follow the fault and we should incline to reach to the fault zone. Now there are 2-3 issues in this. The number one is, when you do the incline mode, there are so many other constraints, especially to operate various instruments. The second is, our location should be very precise, and based on the this observation, prior observation, we would like the identification of fault around 100 meter or so. If we can do that, then we don't have to incline this borehole too much. Very, very slight inclination we may be able to do. So this is the, by and large, the broad design. And these are some of the preliminary surveys we did. All possible geophysical surveys have been done in this region, the seismic stations and the geological mapping, rock, thermal gradiometry, carbon data. So whatever is basically possible to get all kinds of information on this. Now what we got it, the one is, this is a topographic map. You can see that these are our, and the most important is this star, which is tertiary time, and this is a very important aspect of the entire study. The first time we got the complete thickness of the volcanics, because we went right to the granite basement. A lot of studies done on the lava flows which are exposed, but the first time we get the complete idea of this. Some of the important thing which is for geoscientists very critical, that some different plagioclase basalt. This is essentially tells about how the magma has mixed and all. We did not go into the details. We also get a lot of information about the strait wall, which showed that there is a lot of seismic activities. And the most important thing, that there were no sediments. That means after the baseline, about 3.5 billion years or so, till 65 million years, there were no sediments. So it, the tectonic rest directly over the Ionite baseline, and many fault fracture zones and other things which were also found. So this was the first information which we got. Also, which is very critical for our drilling and all, the temperature, because this is very important, that what would be the temperature at that depth. So around 3 km, the model at around 80, and around 6 km, it would be around 130 to 150 degrees. This has been now validated, that this is the temperature at around 3 km, something like this. And roughly, you get about 15 to 16 degree rise at every 1 km. Also, we found that the fault, which was responsible for 1967 Lunachi fault, we could trace it right up to the basement, and we found that some of the weak planes, which is quite in other direction than the pre-existing, that means the current seismic activities, whatever the weak zones they have introduced, we could locate. We also find a lot of sedimentary mineralization along the older fissures and fractures, that means water does go right up to the basement, which is coming from the reservoir. Also, the fault zone have been found. Also, the other studies, which is in gravity basin, which shows that the seismicity has been associated with the density and velocity anomalies. And the rock strength is, the granite which is there is roughly half than what normal granite would be. And this is weakened because successive seismic activities and the stress which is currently available, that there is no likelihood of a large earthquake taking place. So that means we may have a smaller earthquakes at this, but not very large earthquake. Now this is the pilot borehole which is we have just completed on 11th June, which is very vertical, almost maximum is around 3 degrees or so. And the important thing is, we are going to have a perforated casing for the stress measurements. These are some of the features which is very important for to understand the fault zones, which is called the brittle deformation, slick and spikes, pseudotachylite. This is very important because it tells us that the material got fused, which is very high temperature, when the fault took place. And you can see the shattering, the large amount of rocks. This is a micrograph. Many other features like gorge, and this is seen very clearly. So basically, is this all tells that the fault does extend right up to the basement level. And then we also did many others geophysical logging. This is very interesting about electric resistivity and the acoustics. Where you can see the fractures, this is the drilling induced fractures we call. It tells us the where the horizontal stress is directed. So this is very clear from this, is more or less parallel to the vertical. And also there is another important area which is we call as breakouts. This also happens during drilling, and this also tells us that the direction of the maximum is perpendicular. I think the time is up, so I will just quickly go through. So basically, we have been able to do that the rock, they are not strong enough, and the fault zone has been located, and we have started now doing the modeling part, which is of course very simple modeling, which is only one parameter, hope and the different permeability at different months. And this tells us that about 5 years is required to create that kind of a slip. So there are many other studies which could be done, but in the short of time I will go to detail.
very much, Dr. Shailesh Nayak. I think we have time for maybe quick one or two questions or comments from somebody else. Yes.
What is the direction of the tectonic thrust?
What is the? Tectonic stress is already existing there.
What is the direction, geographical direction?
They are all vertical.
But the movement is horizontal.
So that is about northwest, southwest
kind of
thing. You didn't get a chance to mention the geomicrobiological
things.
And I'm curious to know what kinds, just very briefly.
Yeah, actually the experiment is being done by Dr. Pinaki sir from IIT Kharagpur, and he has collected a lot of samples, and the initial he could locate a lot of cyanobacteria in the continental crust in the granitic basement, and he says this is very critical for understanding the what happened during the evolution of the earth and the earlier times. So you may contact him. Actually, there are many other experiments like radio magnetism and on the mass extinction and so many things going on. I don't think so, because he asked a very pertinent question. Secondly, what kind of faults are also very critical, whether it is a thrust fault, whether it is a normal or a strike. The normally it is seen that the reservoir impounding is the earthquake can trigger only if it is a normal fault. So, generally, strike slip faults, there may be chance, but normally thrust faults, there won't be any chance of trigger earthquake.
The fault location already.
Why? You are up 100 meters, you have to do a lot of inclination. We would like, ideally, would like about 10 meters plus a mile. May not happen, but at least with the new instruments now we will put, we should be